Hey guys, it is, oh gosh. I was actually adding it up the other day. This is the third full week, or the beginning of the third week, that I have not been allowed to report to work. It seems like it's been so much longer than that, but it's only the beginning of the third week. So, yay, no. I don't know about you, but I am ready to be back at work. So coronavirus reading, here we go. Out of my mind. We are on chapter 20. I was right about the weather today. I hope the little crocus buds have tiny wool blankets because the temperature dipped back down to the 30s, and our classroom was chilly when we rolled in this morning. The public address system blared the usual Monday morning announcements about bake sales and soccer practice. Most of the time, nobody in H5, not even Mrs. Shannon, pays much attention to them. The craziness of our morning usually takes over. Mrs. Shannon has managed to get us a Wii game system. I don't know how. Willie loves the baseball program. I have learned to keep out of his way while he pretends to hit the ball as he watches the screen. Sometimes his swings go wide. A hit! He'll cry out with a triumph, and then he'll try to run the bases in the classroom. Even Freddie can't keep up with him. I usually sit in a corner with my headphones on, trying to tune it all out. But today, I listened carefully to the bulletin. My heartbeat sped up, and I jerked my arms with excitement as I heard the principal say, "All students who wish to try out for the Whiz Kids quiz team, please report to Mr. Deming's room after school." I stayed nervous all day. I bet I would have been nervous too. I didn't tell Rose what I planned to do. I thought about it and then decided not to. I wonder why she did that. Why do you think she decided? Because I thought Rose was kind of like her best friend. So why do you think she's not choosing to confide in her? Suppose she said it was a stupid idea. I didn't think I could take that. Then I spilled tomato soup all over the front of my blouse at lunchtime, even though Catherine tried to clean it up. Oh, sorry, I lost my place. You just can't get red stuff out of a white shirt. I felt like a slob. I wish I had thought of this morning. I could have told Mom to pack a change of clothes for me. It's still hard to remember that I can say stuff like that now. I didn't go out for inclusion classes all day. I wanted to study until the last minute. But as soon as the last bell rings, I grab Catherine's arm. "Hurry," I type, "to Mr. D's room." Even though I am in the electric chair, we set it to manual so that she can push me. I am too nervous to drive. When we arrive at Mr. Deming's room, a group of kids from my history class are already there, whispering together and going over note cards. They look up in surprise when Catherine wheels me in. "Hi, Melody," Rose says. "What are you doing here?" Her voice doesn't sound as friendly as usual. "Quiz team," I type. "She can't be on the team," I hear Claire whisper to Jessica, wrinkling up her nose. "She's from the retard room." Molly thinks that's really funny. She screeches like a blue jay when she laughs. I decide to ignore them, even though I feel my anger rising. I have to stay focused. Several more students file into the room from both grades, 5 and 6. I don't know the sixth graders very well. They have different recess times. I wonder if they're smarter. They've had more time to learn stuff. A few kids point at me and whisper. When Mr. Deming hurries in carrying a stack of papers sealed in plastic, he scans the room to see who's here. He frowns slightly when he sees me, but he sets the test papers on his desk and greets us all. Not sure if you know this, but we have something called micro expressions. And right before we make an expression, we make an expression, but they call it a micro because think about the word micro, it means tiny. It's just a very subtle, quick, and you might not even realize it at first when people make micro expressions. But that's what she saw in Mr. Deming was that little micro expression before he knew the correct expression to have on his face. She saw maybe his real feelings in that micro expression. "Welcome," he says. I'm so glad that so many of you have chosen to try out for the competition this afternoon. It's going to be challenging as well as fun. Are there any questions before we get started? Connor, of course, raises his hand. Yes, Connor, Mr. Deming says with a good-natured sigh. Will we get pizza and stuff during practice like last year? Don't you think you need to make the team first? His friend Rodney yells out. Rodney is right. Let's do one thing at a time. Mr. Deming lifts the stack of test papers from his desk and holds them like a treasure. I hold in my hand the official test questions from the National Whiz Kids headquarters in Washington, D.C. I will be reading the test questions to you just as it's done in real competitions. And then, he stops and stares. Everyone looks around to see what has interrupted him. It's me. Mr. Deming taps the stack of papers for a minute, clears his throat, and addresses Catherine. You know, I don't think it's appropriate for Melody to be here. This is not a recreational activity just for fun. The purpose of this meeting is to choose our official team. He isn't even speaking to me. He's looking right over my head at Catherine as if I were invisible. Now, I am really mad. I turn up the volume on my machine, very loud. I am here to take the test. Mr. Deming blinks. Melody, I don't want your feelings to get injured. The test is very hard. I am very smart. I just don't want you to be hurt, Melody. He sounds sincere, sort of. I'm tough, I type. You go, girl, Rose suddenly says from the front of the room. A few other kids clap their support. That makes me feel a little better. Just a little. Catherine speaks up. By law, she cannot be excluded. You know that, sir. Yes, but read the questions to the students just as you had planned. They'll write their answers on notebook paper. Melody will record her answers and then print them out for you. How do we know you won't be helping her? Claire asks. Because I won't be in the room, Catherine replies. Too bad, because you might need some help. Catherine grins at her, but Claire just looks away. I tell Catherine, go now. I almost push her away. Thank you. Your mom is coming to pick you up? Yes. Good luck, Melody. You're my champ, no matter what. You got that? Got it. I wave as she leaves. Mr. Deming shrugs his shoulders and continues with the directions. There are 100 quiz questions. I will read each prompt one time and each answer only once. You will have 30 seconds to record each response. Please write only the capital letter A, B, C, D, and sometimes E. Are there any questions? Claire's hand shoots up. Yes. How do we know Melody doesn't have answers stored in her machine? Us normal people aren't allowed to use computers. Why are you so worried about Melody? Rose answers before Mr. D has a chance to. Are you scared that she'll get a higher score than you? No way! Then be quiet so we can get started. Mr. D smiles at Rose. Students, get out 2 sheets of paper. One to write on, one to cover your answers. We believe in honesty, but an extra sheet of paper can't hurt. Everyone shuffles to find paper and pens. Then a feeling of quiet expectation falls over the room. Mr. Deming unseals the official test and opens to the first page. Let us begin, he says, his voice suddenly sounding very official. Number 1. The capital of Colombia is A. Brussels, B. Santiago, C. Bogota, D. Jakarta. He pauses while everybody scribbles their answers. I punch in the letter C. Good old Mrs. V and her capital quiz cards. Number 2, Mr. Deming continues. Gerontology is the study of A, the elderly, B, gerunds, C, germs, D, rocks and jewels. I punch in the letter A. So far, so good. The test continues for the next 30 minutes or so. He asks questions about atoms and clouds, about fish and mammals, about famous religions and dead presidents. Some of the questions I'm sure of, I guess on a couple. The math questions make me sweat. This is the hardest, most exciting thing I've ever done. The very last question is a killer. And number 100, Mr. D says, relief in his voice, the small intestine of an average adult, if stretched out vertically, would measure about how long? A, 8 to 12 inches. B, 1 to 5 feet. C, 5 to 7 feet. D, 20 to 23 feet. I punch in the letter D, hoping I've guessed right, and breathe a sigh of relief. Whew, it was over. Pencils down, please, Mr. Deming tells us. Make sure your name is on your paper, then cover it with the cover sheet and pass it up to me. As everyone gathers papers and scribbles their names hurriedly, I push the print button on my Metatalker. A slim sheet with my answers emerges from the side. Mr. Deming walks back to where I sit and rips it off. He doesn't look at me. We're done here, he tells the class. Your parents were told what time to pick you up, but if anyone has a problem with the ride, let me know. I won't leave the building until everyone has safely left school grounds. I am the last one out. I know my mom will probably come in to get me, but I want to leave on my own power. I turn on my chair and wheel around to face the door. Melody, Mr. D calls. I spin back around. I hope you were not discouraged by all this. I was only trying to protect you from being hurt. I'm okay, I tell him. I'll be announcing the scores and the members of the team tomorrow. I just don't want you to be disappointed. I understand. Then I ask him, top 8 scores get picked? Yes, 4 team members and 4 alternates. I am tired, and I've started to drool a little. I'm sure he thinks I'm a dunce, a sloppy one at that. I feel like the red stain on my blouse is screaming. Okay, good night. Good night, Melody. See you tomorrow. And you might want to wipe your mouth. I rub the sleeve of my shirt across my lips, the tomato-stained shirt. I can imagine what he is thinking. I almost bump into my mom as she hurries in. How did you do, sweetie? She asks breathlessly. Okay, I guess. To Mr. D, she says, thank you for giving her the opportunity to participate. My pleasure, Mrs. Brooks. Melody is a delight, and I'm amazed she's been able to achieve as well as she has. Yeah, right. A delight with drippy lips and a dirty shirt. Let's go, Mom, I type. I need to go to the bathroom, and I want to go home. I'm so sad as a teacher because I don't like the way he's treating her. It's very obvious how he feels that because of her physical limitations, that it means she also has mental and educational limitations. And she doesn't. And as teachers, as people, as human beings, we should never judge people like that. It's not our place. We have no idea what someone's capable of. The sky truly is the limit. It's every person has the capability to do whatever is in their heart to do. Might not be the best at it, but they're capable of trying. And all we have to do is get behind them and believe in their dreams with them. And so as a teacher, I'm really sad how he's speaking to her and about her and not even to her sometimes, to people who help with her, because she's a person and she needs to be talked to. So anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed it. I can't wait until tomorrow's chapter so we can find, I hope the author tells us in the next chapter. I hope we don't have to wait another whole chapter to find out if she gets in. Yay, bye.